Catholics around the world mark the most important and meaningful celebration of their faith, Lent and Easter. In the Philippines, Holy Week is rich in tradition. On Maundy Thursday, Catholics witness the washing of the feet, a reenactment of Jesus' humility and willingness to serve. After that, Catholics visit at least 7 churches for the Visita Iglesia. On Good Friday, Catholics mark the crucifixion, the ultimate sacrifice of Jesus Christ. And on Easter Sunday, Catholics celebrate the Lord's resurrection. But some Filipino Catholics have deviated from church tradition. How can Filipinos have an enriching experience this Holy Week? How can this time be more meaningful for those seeking God, His healing, and grace?
It is Holy Week, and for Catholics, this is a time to repent, reflect, and renew their faith. Spirituality comes from within, and Holy Week is just one time in an entire year when we should all be filled with holiness and grace that comes only from a soul at peace. How can we make the most out of this Holy Week and our everyday lives? With us, we have Bishop Raul Martinez. He is Bishop Emeritus of Antique and resident bishop at Christ the King Parish in Green Meadows, Quezon City. Thank you very much, Bishop, for joining us. He's also chair, co-chair of the Holy Land Subic Sanctuary and Theme Park project that is under planning and preparation stage right now. We also have with us Father Manuling Francisco from the Society of Jesus, composer behind many, many beautiful religious songs. I'm sure once you hear it, you will remember. And now you see Father Manuling himself here. And we also have Maribee Mapa. She runs the Bethesda Healing Center. Thank you very much for joining us. You saw all the little clip that we put on television here about the different Lenten rites. Is this something that still happens? And are the Filipinos now, especially the youth, still observing or commemorating in the way it should be, Bishop?
I guess so. For all the bad publicity that is going on about spirituality in these days, when we come to the Philippines, we see a different picture. And when we observe our churches, they are packed with people. Of course, that's another question. But just that fact is already a beautiful message for us, that faith in the Philippines is still strong.
And how do you think they define their faith, or they live this faith?
That's another question. That's a very good question, Tina.
Yes.
Because the fear is that this remains purely an external practice without any interiorization of it. And that is why some years ago, I think that Father, the Jesuit priest who wrote Split-Level Christianity, I think he described it very well, because we have compartmentalized.
Eugene Moran.
Was it?
Father Eugene.
Father Bulatao also.
Father Bulatao,
Bulatao,
Father,
yes.
Bulatao. He described it very well, because we tend to compartmentalize. We have been compartmentalizing our faith. So we practice my faith on this level. I practice my daily life on another level.
Disrespectful here when I talk about a generation. Is there a generation gap between Bishop Raul and Father Manuling here? in the way you view spirituality. So this is his observation. And you, Father, you're very young.
Right. Hopefully, he's still young.
Yeah. So is there something common in what the bishop is saying, or you see things differently as well?
I agree with Bishop Raul's comments and insights, no? That wherever I go during the Lenten season, the churches are packed because people yearn to hear the Word of God. People yearn to be renewed spiritually. But the problem, as the good bishop has mentioned, is that we may live out a sacramental spirituality, but be remiss in living out and witnessing to our faith in the way we deal with one another in society. And therefore, there is still that problem of interiorization, not only among the youth, but mm-hmm. even among the elder Catholics. Mm-hmm. It's a common problem of how to interiorize and make more relevant and effective the faith that we preach and the faith that we live out.
Mm-mm. Marie B here is not in any congregation, is not a nun. She is a very successful individual in business, and in fact is spearheading a project that maybe we can talk about later. But she is a lay person who's very much into how do you describe the work that you do as a lay person?
I feel now my calling is to be a grandmother, a mother, and full-time servant of God, because He pulled me from the banking world and the commercial world to really serve Him through my healing ministry and through this project that we are doing for creative evangelization. So even the young will be attracted, and I focus my energies there now. We give seminars all over the Philippines for values formation and healing. So I guess I've been pirated by the Lord to serve Him.
Pirated, I like that.
From the business world to serve Him, to do His business as a wife and a mother. Well, of course, the wife and mother and grandmother is also part of that.
Mm-hmm. Bishop, in your own parish or in Antique that we talk about, what is the interiorization that you speak about? How is an elderly woman, maybe a senior citizen who's been there for a long time and is a Catholic, goes to Mass regularly, is her being Catholic manifested in her relationship with her family, in the community? Is that now being a different kind of a Catholic that is helping the others in the community?
That is
very sa pamilya lang sila. They're religious, they have all the santos in the house, but they don't actually go out and help the poor. Is there a growing sense now of helping the poor or helping the others?
Yes, yes and no, Tina. What I mean there is that I'm always surprised when you see these elderly ladies. We call them the Beatas.
Yes.
And we would think that it was a purely individualistic kind of religion that they had. It is true that they were not so concerned about the plight of the poor, about all this, because they are themselves the poor ones. And yet, when it comes to helping others, that's where their Christianity comes to the fore. Mm-hmm. That has always amazed me. Mm-hmm. When I hear, I'm not talking mm-hmm. against the theologians, but when we talk about, in fact, let me cite one example, Tina. I had the seminarians, and I would send them out during weekends. Mm-hmm. And one seminarian came back to me, and he said, "You know, Bishop, I was surprised when I was sharing the word of God with these Beatas, with these elderly people in the barrios. I was amazed at the insights that they gave."
Insights into life or spirituality, religion?
Yes.
Everything.
Everything.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. That means that it's the Holy Spirit that's working in there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They may not have all these new ideas about liberation theology or about all these insights into the Bible, but what they have comes from the Lord.
Mm-hmm. Father Manuling, are these experiences that the bishop talks about part of how you actually, as a priest, teach the younger generation or the youth about religion, about spirituality? Maybe my question, how do you even teach
theology. Right.
Very difficult, no? Because among the young people today, my sensing is that they're looking for credible witnesses. Mm. And they're very critical of the older generation's spirituality. Mm-hmm. That isn't interiorized, no? And therefore, they're critical of authorities, whether church, government authorities, who do not live out what they practice. And therefore, the spirituality that the young people are looking for and try to embrace is one that fuses orthodoxy and orthopraxis.
What is that?
Right belief, but also right practice. So, kumbaga, I think that's why the Gawad Kalinga and the Habitat for Humanity and all the microfinancing projects and all the environmental preservation programs are very attractive to the young people, no? Because they're looking for concrete results, a concrete way of living out their spiritual and religious convictions. Mm-hmm. Hindi sapat lang yung magnovena, magrosaryo, magsimba. Kailangan ipakita sa pakikisalamuha sa kapwa-tao, sa lipunan, at sa kapaligiran. And therefore, they're looking for a more relevant and concrete way of living out their faith.
And do they get to transform that experience into a religious experience? Mm-hmm. They think it is a blessed experience for them, or this is already their mortification or sacrifice? Mm-hmm. I mean, is there something like that in their acts?
Well, because when we preach
helping?
About the coming of God's kingdom and God's salvation, all these become too heady unless they experience it in the here and now of communities being uplifted from poverty, families being reunited. And therefore, there is a need indeed to bring about that integration between what we proclaim and what we live out, no? And unless the older people, the older Catholics, are able to bear witness to that integrated spirituality, then the young people will ever be critical of us and look for other ways, other avenues to live out this need for credibility and relevance.
Yeah, we will get back more about making our Holy Week and our lives outside of Holy Week more meaningful when we return. You're watching Talkback.